Pray for me, sir. Me and Akon and children went to school together. This is not about Akon. It's not about me. The church. And we all heard the good side of
Twitter.
I'm gonna tell Sam that I know. Twitter would fight.
Yes.
Could fight and would fight. And did fight. And we get mad, not angry, mad when we wouldn't fight. Twitter was like that up until the time she came to church. Did anybody guess what she came to do? Somebody said, get saved. Twitter came to fight. But the Holy Ghost, the Holy Ghost fell. I didn't know what myself, the power fell on me. It had to be the power because it sent her down on her knees. And she started calling Jesus. And she got saved that night. Now most of y'all know she could kind of snap you up at times. But then glory, woo! She changed from that. She pulled up and pulled up and pulled up until she got where she's at today. Going home to God.
Oh,
song as it was sung in the red clay hills of Georgia. As slaves would moan, and as the mind of Thomas Dorsey would release this hymn. Dear Lord, I love your name.
February 5th, 2012. as she led a fiery devotional service at the Church of Philadelphia. Deaconess Gary's spiritual life began as unexpectedly, as her final call from the Master. The songwriter must have had Deaconess Gary in mind when he wrote the soul-stirring lyrics. I went to a service one night and my soul wasn't right. Something got a hold of me. Tilla, as she was affectionately nicknamed by her father, attended a revival at the request of her mother. Tilla at the time had smoked on a daily basis for more than 20 years, thinking in her mind, I won't be here very long. She went to the building with a full pack of cigarettes and a determination to complete them once the service was over. However, a glorious change was made that night. Amen. And by the end of that service, she had a new mind and was filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Emmanuel often boasted in Christ of his power, which allowed her to stop smoking cold turkey, never again having a craving or taste of nicotine, which held her captive for so long. I think everybody who came today received the program. If not everybody, just about everybody.
That's right.
So when you get a minute in your quiet time, you read what we took our time and skillfully placed each word in its place.
Yeah.
Right now, I'm going to close it.
All
right. And I'm going to take just this few minutes that I would have taken to read what's been written.
Come on.
To tell you something.
Yes,
that's,
come on.
It's not captured.
It's all right. It's all right.
In this trifold.
All right.
The lady that we're celebrating and honoring today is my mom. And she's my best friend. My mom was a really, really special person. She had a heart of gold. Although you could not always easily identify her heart, because sometimes it was camouflaged and sometimes she didn't come across to everybody the way that you may have wanted her to. But she was one of the sweetest people you ever was to. I often think about some of my more troubling times and a time of hardship when she was there to see me through. A lot of times she was there holding me up when I thought I couldn't stand on my own. My mother was somebody you could go to in the wee hours of the night, early in the morning. It didn't matter when or where, what your problem or situation was. Her answer was always prayer. She always told you what mama said, what grandma said. Grandma, as far as my mother was concerned, and God was all that it took. And she prayed us through every situation. No matter what we went through, my mother was a praying woman, and she prayed us through. She was somebody who loved to cook. She didn't care what or why or how. And on many holidays, there was more neighbors there than family members. But she would open up her doors and she would feed them. She was somebody who was always such a caring person. I want Larry, whatever he is, to stand up. I can't see real good. But my brother Larry, when Larry was only 2 weeks old, my mom extended our family and took Larry in and extended the family because she was that kind of caring person. His mother is still very active in his life, but my mother is also viewed as his mother because that's just the kind of person she was.
That's right, that's right.
And I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that the prayer service that she said on Tuesdays and the Sunday Bible school conviction, her role in that position is what prepared her for her transition. I have no doubt in my mind that those two things were part of what helped her to make her. She loved her role as superintendent. dollar hurting so bad. I don't think I'm going to go. And as bad as my mom was hurting, maybe I didn't have permission, but I signed her excuse. Mom, you stay home. And when I got to Sunday school, my mother was already there in a position. She was such a loving and caring person. I can't say it enough. And she was my best friend. For so long, I said, when I grew up, I didn't have girlfriends. I didn't feel slighted. I didn't feel like I was
right. Come on, man.
I didn't have my reasons for not having them was my choice, wow. Not my force. Yeah. I chose her as my friend, and she chose me as hers. I didn't want other friends because she was all that I needed. We hung out and did a lot of things together. The other thing my mother was really fond of was family gatherings. She loved her people. And she would say in a heartbeat, a coffee? Come on, a coffee? A coffee can heal a coffee. She was the backbone. My mother was the glue that held us together. And I declared the other night when I was laying there about 4 o'clock in the morning, tossing and turning throughout it all, I didn't lose my appetite. I did lose a couple nights sleep, but I didn't lose my appetite. And as I laid there at night, I heard her just as clear say, y'all see about each other. Because that's the kind of person she was. She was concerned and caring about her kids and wanted to make sure that they were all right. And I don't believe she would have made it over and gone had she had the slightest inkling that we weren't together, wasn't what we needed to be.
That's right. That's
and I believe our finest moment was us preparing as a family for our home home. We worked together like kids. We worked together like children. Taught us to work together. We came together as a family and we made her proud.
Yeah,
we worked out the program and see what had to be done. And Yvonne and Aunt Ray and Uncle Brother there as a support. But that's what they were as a support. We did this thing and we're so proud.
Yeah.
I want y'all to know who she was.
Yeah.
This paper gives you an idea of who she was.
That's right.
But she was such a sweet person.
She was.
And when I look at the view, the congregation, those that are on the floor and those that are in the balcony, I see how much love you had for all. As well as the service, that Tuesday night, that Tuesday prayer service. The house was full. The house was full.
People
cared and loved her. I thank you so much on behalf of my sisters and brothers, on behalf of Marcus, Larry, and Daphne. I thank you all. I thank you on behalf of her 29 grands and her 32 grands and 29 great grands. And when she was going through her stages of cancer, I remember, and I'm gonna say something, sit down after this. I saw her the night before, and we were talking, and everything was fine. That very next day, I saw her, and she had a baseball cap on. I didn't know why, but I knew she was, you know, had the cancer thing, and she took her hat off, and her head was as clear as my fist. And I said, oh, mom, and she said, stop, don't do that. She said, I'm all right. She said, I'm gonna be okay. And I say to all of you here, cancer didn't take my mother out of life. Cancer did not take my mother out of life. Cancer did not win. She died healed of cancer. I want the story to go out, and I want it to go out right. Cancer did not take my mother out of here. And I thank God. Thank God. Thank you.
the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. I will bless the Lord at all time, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. On behalf of Reverend Marcus Allen and the Terray Memorial Funeral Chapel and staff, we would like to take this opportunity to present this memorial plaque to you on behalf of your loved one, Deaconess Emanuela Gary. We believe that on February the 12th, 2012, she looked toward heaven and said these words, "Long live me."
What you were saying, Justine.
Began to confess the goodness of the Lord.
that stuck out in my mind and left an indelible mark on me as she began to sing, "The Word Brought Me Here."
Yes, sir.
It was a tremendous testimony because she then went on to rattle off Son of God, Mary's Baby, Rose of Sharon, Lily in the Valley, and she began to confess who God was to her. And if I had some opening and closing thought, I don't believe Aunt Tittle would mind if I stole those words and my subject and simply say, "The Lord brought us here. The Lord has brought us to this moment." And when we look at the story of Ruth, if ever there was a person who had set out on a journey and some unexpected things popped up, it was Ruth and her mother-in-law, Naomi.
Yes.
Now, we have spent a considerable amount of time dealing with Ruth. After all, the book is named after Ruth. It is Ruth who marries Boaz. It is Ruth who gives birth to the son who has the birthright given to Jesse and then given to David. It is Ruth who extends the line into the New Testament, where we read that Jesus comes down from the line of Ruth and Boaz. And so it seems ill-placed to be talking about Naomi today. But I want to talk about Naomi because Naomi is going through a transition much like you and I today. And if you want to talk about someone who is dealing with sorrow, someone who is dealing with grief, Naomi has just lost her husband, and then she loses Milan, and then she loses Chilion. Somewhere out there on the journey, Orpah gets kind of scared and decides to turn back. And so it's just her and her God and her daughter-in-law out there on the journey. It has always struck me as quite interesting that these two women, on the fringes of society and acceptability, have started back to Bethlehem in the middle of their grief and now have to figure out, what do we do in the aftermath of our loss? I wonder sometimes what they talked about. I wonder if they remember the good times. I wonder if they remember the meals that they cooked. I wonder if they remember going to Sabbath together. I wonder if they remember the moments of laughter, because as I stand here, those are the memories that flood over me today. And as I look out at this family and all of the memories that Aunt Tittle has left us with, those are the things that come back as you're on the journey. And so it begs of the question, what do we do in the aftermath? When the choir has sung, when the committal is given, after we leave this place and you are home in the quietude of your grief, how do you deal with the deep sorrow of your soul? I tell you, I look at Ruth because she says some words that are very interesting. She says to God and of God, "I went out full. I have returned again home empty." But better yet, she says to God, "You bought me home empty." And it made me really consider the words of Naomi, because Naomi has often been thought of as one of those folks that charge God foolishly, as you said, Prophet McCoy. But when I begin to really consider what Naomi was saying, she was in a sense placing God culpable for the situation that she was in. In other words, she was saying that, "God, you are responsible for where I am." And it seems in a sense that maybe she was holding God accountable in some kind of evil way. But I understand today what Naomi was saying. Naomi was saying, "Lord, you are responsible for the position in which I am. And if you are responsible for where I am, you are responsible for what I've become in my loss." I say to the family today that God is imminent. He is in this situation. God is present in the middle of our loss, and he is responsible. And it's all right to hold God accountable.
understand that it is in the midst of loss that we find out really who God is. And over the course of her life, Antuna had found out that God was a lily in the valley. She had tried God, found out he was Rose of Sharon. He had extended her hand, his hand to her in the midst of love. And she knew him as the Son of God. But she knew also that he could hold you in the middle of your loss. But she also knew that God could be a healer.
number as close as you can.
Is it cold enough for y'all out here? Ooh. I got my long johns on. No. Ooh. Look at my thing.
Sunset, evening star. One clear call for me. May there be no morning of the far. I'm put out to sea. Twilight and evening bell. And after that, the dark. And may there be no sadness of farewell when I embark. Lord Jesus.
You're okay.
Blessed are the poor, pure in heart, for they shall see God. I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, right blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from his forth. Yea, say in the spirit, they may rest from their labor, and their works do follow them. The righteous perish, and no man layeth to heart. Merciful men are taken the way. None considering that the righteous is taken away from evil to come. Inasmuch as it has pleased the Almighty God in his wisdom and power to take out of this world the soul of the deceased. At present, it is at our duty to commit the body to its kindred's elements. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, looking for the coming of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who shall appear the second time unto those that look for him without sin unto salvation. And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give every man according as his work shall be. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have a right to the tree of life, and may enter in through the gates in the city.
Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for the opportunity that you have given us to God. Lord, we thank you for the life and the legacy of our grandmother, of our aunt, our friend. Dear God, we thank you for what she left with us, oh God. Lord, grant us peace, dear God. Give us understanding. Where we're torn down, build us up. Where we're weak, dear God, make us strong. Dear God, let us not leave this place the same. Dear God, help us to do what we have to do that we may see her again. Dear God, help us to understand that the Bible said that the dead in Christ shall rise, and they that remain thereafter shall be caught up. Dear God, we look forward to that great day where we'll see our deceased loved one again, oh God. Lord, give us strength now, God. Lord, we can't wait till tomorrow. We can't wait till next week, God. Lord, we need you now, God.
Yes, yes.
Give us strength like never before. Lord, give us wings like eagles, oh God. In the mighty name of Jesus, to God, bind the family together in the name of Jesus, to God. Help us to love one another, to God. Lord, help tragedy not to beget tragedy, dear God. But let tragedy beget triumph, oh God, in the name of Jesus. And God, as we leave this place, dear God, but never from your presence, dear God, keep us under your umbrella of protection, dear God. Let your loving, warm arms be wrapped kindly around us. In Jesus' name we do pray. And the people of God did say after praying, Amen.
And our benediction, the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and the sweet communion of the Holy Ghost be with us all forevermore. Amen.
Amen. That's our children at this time, if you all will come up and place your flowers upon the casket, our children. Be careful and watch your step, please. Her sisters, sisters present, all of her grandkids, all of her grandchildren. Is her brother present? Where's he at?
Oh,
the
brother, right here.
Oh, right here. Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm
ready about it.
Uncle, brother. I didn't even know who.
All of her nieces, nephews. All grandchildren, all grandkids. Great, 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 greats. All of the cousins, the church family, all family.